If you are taking your own notes, the message title today is Where Are You Looking? And I'd like you to find the text. We're going to read it in a few minutes' time, but the text is James chapter 1, so you can find that. And I'm going to teach you this morning on the greatest key to Christian victory. If you want to live in victory as a Christian, if you can grasp a hold of what I'm about to share with you, it can absolutely revolutionize your life from this point on. When Christy and I first got married, I think it was first or second year, she bought me a really wonderful Christmas present, and it was an advanced driving school. And for a couple of days, I went to Sandown race course, and I had an SS Holden back in those days, which was very exciting. Just before we started having children, at which point Christy talked me into getting rid of my SS Holden because apparently it wasn't a family car. Seriously? So I had to get something a little more conservative when the kids came along. But I loved my SS. And, you know, there was one night after church, I was out in the car park, and some of the youth gathered around. They were the young guys. They were looking at the car and they're going, wow, it's a really cool car. And then they tempted me. And they said, come on, Pastor Rob, lay some rubber. And I gave in to the temptation. It was a confession session. It overcame me. You know, I kind of prayed that prayer that sometimes we pray, Lord, deliver me from temptation, but not too quickly. And so I didn't want to let them down, you know what I'm saying? So I did, I gunned the thing and then I let it go and I screeched out of the car park and I did fishtails down Argus Street. It was really cool. I know some of you shaking your heads. Yeah, I'm better now, although if I had an SS, I'd probably still lay a bit of rubber. It was fun. Anyway, Chelsea was our youth leader at the time and I've only ever been called into a staff member's office once. And that was the occasion. And she sat me down and said, Pastor Rob, you're being a really bad influence on the youth. I was like, really? Seriously? They enjoyed it. So anyway, I took the warning, but it was a lot of fun. And so I did this advanced driving school and you get to basically put your car through its paces with a group of people. They give various obstacles around the race course and you know, oil slicks and all sorts of stuff. And one of the particular things that you had to do was they put all of these obstacles on the race course, the racing track rather, and as you came around a corner, you had to try to maneuver around the obstacles and not hit anything. And so the first time, all of us went around there in our cars and all of us hit some of the obstacles. And then the guy that was training us, he called us together and he said, okay, just out of interest, where did you look? And all of us had looked at the obstacles that we weren't supposed to hit. And he said, that's the problem. He said, when you're approaching a traffic hazard, the majority of people look at the hazard and you end up hitting what you're looking at. So he said, I want you to do this exercise again, but this time I want you to look at where you don't want to hit. And so all of us got in our cars and we did it again. And as we came around the corner, we looked for the gap and we stared at the gap. And it was quite amazing. As you look at the gap, as you look at what you don't want to hit, your car just automatically follows and none of us hit any of the obstacles. A number of years later, I was up in Sydney at a men's conference with a number of Bayside guys. We'd hired a Tarago, and on the way back from the men's conference to the airport to fly back to Melbourne. I was driving down, I think it was Military Road in Mosman, and some car in front did this crazy thing, and there was another car here, and there was just this really, really small gap, and everything I had learned kicked in at that moment, and I looked at the gap and maneuvered the Tarago through this accident waiting to happen. And a couple of the guys sitting toward the front saw what went on. They go, wow, that was awesome. How did you do that? And I shared with them that principle. I felt like going back and showing them all again, you know, kind of in slow-mo. But I resisted the temptation. Psychologists actually have a name for this. It's called target fixation. And a definition of it is it's a phenomenon that's observed in humans in which an individual becomes so focused on an observed object, be it a target or a hazard, that they inadvertently increase their risk of colliding with the object. Target fixation. I love watching surfing. And I know we have a number of people at church here that surf, so you'll know this principle. Next time you watch surfing, watch where the head of the surfer goes. Their board might be facing in that direction, but they want to go here on the wave. And so as they're going there, you'll notice that their head will turn. And as their head turns, the board maneuvers back down the wave. And then they want to go this way, so they turn their head again. Wherever they look, that's where they go. It's the same with cars. It's the same with motorbikes. I don't frequent biker websites until this week. And I found a really interesting statement here in this, this article from a motorbike website. Understanding this concept is another critical piece of the riding puzzle. Go where you look means that when riding, you and your motorcycle will go to wherever you are looking. Here are three examples. Number one, when you see a pothole coming up and you stare at it while you are approaching it, odds are that you will hit it. Number two, making a tight U-turn on a residential street and halfway through the turn you look at the opposing curb, odds are that you will hit the curb. Number three, during a gradual turn on a two-lane road, you look at the oncoming traffic, odds are that you will ride right into the oncoming traffic, which is never a good thing. He goes on, he says, it sounds crazy, it did to me at first, but I'm here to tell you that it is the truth. In each of these three examples, as soon as you realize you are heading into a problem, immediately look away from the pothole, the curb, the oncoming traffic, and look at where you really want to go. If you are not too far into the pending collision, changing your look will change your direction in time to avoid an imminent crash. Looking at the spot that you are trying to avoid will suck you into that spot every time. Looking at the spot where you do want to go will move your motorcycle towards that spot. One of my favorite scenes from a brilliant movie, A Bug's Life, beautifully illustrates this in animation form. Have a look at the screens.
I can't help it. It's so beautiful.
And that's it. Pure and simple. It's so beautiful. And this beautifully demonstrates this principle. Where you look is where you'll go. Let's personalize this and say it together. Where I look is where I go. Together, where I look is where I go. So, coming back to the title of this message, where are you looking? For the Christian, our victory lies in where we gaze. Are you looking at your sin, or are you looking at your righteousness, your right relationship in Jesus Christ? Are you sin conscious, or are you righteousness conscious? And James addresses both of these things in the beginning part of his letter. So I trust that you found James chapter 1 by now. And we're going to read from verse 13. And James says, when tempted, no one should say, God is tempting me. For God cannot be tempted by evil, nor does he tempt anyone. But each person is tempted when they are dragged away by their own evil desire and enticed. Then after desire has conceived, it gives birth to sin. And sin, when it is full grown, gives birth to death. Don't be deceived, my dear brothers and sisters. Every good and perfect gift is from above, coming down from the Father of the heavenly lights, who does not change like shifting shadows. In these verses, James is teaching on where we focus if we are to live in victory and to live in the goodness of God. And so we're going to spend a few minutes focusing on those two things. First of all, focus on sin, and then secondly, focus on righteousness. So let's look at those two. Number one, focused on sin or being sin conscious. What does that do in our lives? James here says that each person is tempted when they are dragged away by their own evil desires and enticed. The words dragged away are translated from one Greek word, which is exelko, and it literally means to lure. If you're into fishing, you know about lures. You get a lure, and it's maybe the shape of a fish, or it looks exactly like a fish that you're trying to catch, and it looks like it's just swimming around, so other fish like that will swim around it, but it's to entice. It's to drag away the fish that you want to catch. There's a lot of hunting lures as well. I know that we're not big into hunting here in Melbourne, but if you go into the outback of Australia, or particularly if you go to a country like America, hunting is a massive industry. And I spent a little bit of time online just having a look at this, and I found out that there are American hunting lures for pretty well any animal that they would wish to hunt. And so you can buy moose urine hunting lure, which apparently smells like moose urine, and you spray it around and it lures them. It entices them, just like sin will entice us and then drag us away. You can buy Blaine Anthony's Bear Whisperer scent. You can get Top Secret Hot Mama Deer scent and Muskrat Liquid Trapping Lure, as well as a myriad of others. Lures of all for all types of animals so that they can shoot them and drag them away. And that is a very good example of what temptation does to us. Our evil desires, they lure us, they entice us, they tempt us. And when desire has conceived, James goes on, that word in the Greek language literally means to become pregnant. And so when we keep focusing on our sin, something happens. We're looking at it, we will hit it. Target fixation. And if we keep looking at in that direction, then it conceives. We become pregnant with it. And then it says it gives birth to sin because we're sin conscious. And sin, when it's full grown, when it grows up, gives birth to death. And that's not a good thing, however you look at it. Death in this context means all the miseries arising from sin. So the consequences of our wrong action, and also the loss of a life consecrated to God and blessed by Him here on this earth. Over my 30 plus years as a pastor, I have watched this in too many people who have persisted in sinful activity in some shape or form in their lives, and they've not listened to the warnings of people who love them, and they've not listened to the little nudges of the Holy Spirit. And they've persisted in that direction. And you watch as their life in Christ just starts to go cold. And they start to drift and you start to see them less. And it's not good. At any time, any moment, they can reverse that process and redevelop their relationship, their friendship with the Lord. But if they continue to persist, it's almost like they grow completely cold and disinterested in the things of God. Why? Because they're sin conscious, not righteousness conscious. We have a choice, either death to self or death of self. And if you're in any wonder, pick the first. We shouldn't take sin lightly. When we sin, we need to deal with it. We need to confess it. But then we need to move on in the forgiveness and grace of God. Don't continue to focus on your sin. Don't be sin conscious, because where you look is where you'll go. The Bible is absolutely alive with promises of God's grace and God's forgiveness. And we're going to put a few of these up on the screen for you. And you can meditate on these in your own time. They're absolutely wonderful promises of the grace of God and God's forgiveness. In 1 John chapter 1 and verse 9, it says, if we confess our sins. Now, let's just stop there for a moment. The word confess actually means to agree with. And so all God is asking is that when we sin, we would agree with God that what we've done is wrong. Those of you who are parents, you have children, all you want your kids to do, you know they've done the wrong thing, right? You know it. All you want them to do as a parent is to stop denying. I didn't do anything wrong. I haven't done it. I didn't do it. You know they did it. All you want as a parent is for the kids to come to you and go, you know what? I did it. Okay, so we can deal with this now. And God's the same. He says, just if you sin, when you sin, agree with me that what you've done is wrong. And then we can deal with it. And the way God deals with it is wonderful. If we confess our sins, he is faithful and just and will forgive us our sins. And then it goes even further, not just forgiveness, but it says, purify us from all unrighteousness. That word purify means to cleanse or to wash. It's like if you've got a stain on your shirt, you spray some Vanish on it and it vanishes. It's a miracle. God has heavenly Vanish. God, I've sinned. Yeah, I know. Lord, I'm really sorry. That's fine. Let me forgive you. And then let us spray. And it vanishes. He purifies it. You can go back to him 5 minutes later. Let's talk about that. Talk about what? Because God can choose to not just forgive, but also forget. And he won't drag it up again and use it against you at any time. He's not like some husbands and wives. They don't just get hysterical, they get historical. And they drag up all the stuff in the past. No, God just lets it go. Aren't you glad? Amen. Psalm 32, verse 5, then I acknowledged my sin to you and did not cover up my iniquity. I said, I will confess my transgressions to the Lord, and you forgave the guilt of my sin. Psalm 51, which is a beautiful song that David wrote when he committed adultery with Bathsheba. And in verse 2, it says, wash away all my iniquity and cleanse me from my sin. Proverbs 28, verse 13, whoever conceals their sins does not prosper, but the one who confesses and renounces them finds mercy. Isaiah 55, verses 6 and 7, seek the Lord while he may be found, call on him while he is near. Let the wicked forsake their ways and the unrighteous their thoughts. Let them turn to the Lord and he will have mercy on them and to our God, for he will freely pardon. Ezekiel 18, verses 30 to 32, repent, turn away from all your offenses. Then sin will not be your downfall. Rid yourselves of all the offenses you have committed and get a new heart and a new spirit, a fresh start. Why will you die, people of Israel? For I take no pleasure in the death of anyone, declares the sovereign Lord. Repent and live. In Psalm 103, verses 2 to 3 and verse 12, praise the Lord, my soul, and forget not all his benefits, who forgives all your sins. As far as the east is from the west, so far has he removed our transgressions from us. And it's very profound that he talks about east and west, not north and south. If you go from the North Pole to the South Pole, that's a measurable distance. But you cannot measure the gap between east and west. If you go east, you just keep going east. If you go west, you just keep going west. It's immeasurable. And that's how far God has removed our sins, our transgressions from us. Is that good news? So far away, he's not going to bring them back. When we face him on the day of judgment, he's not going to drag up all the stuff we've done. Why? Because it's been dealt with through Jesus' death and his resurrection. Micah 7, verses 18, 19. Where is another God like you who pardons guilt, overlooking the sins of his special people? You will not stay angry with your people forever because you delight in showing unfailing love. Once again, you will have compassion on us. You will trample our sins under your feet and throw them into the depths of the ocean. Beautiful metaphorical language, isn't it? There's your sins. God's going to flatten them out, just like we do with cardboard boxes when you put them into the recycle, except God is not going to recycle our sins. He flattens them, and then he takes them, and he throws them into the depths of his ocean. That is bubbling away, flattened on the bottom of the sea. Romans 4, 7 and 8. Blessed are those whose transgressions are forgiven, whose sins are covered. Blessed is the one whose sin the Lord will never count against them. You're blessed. If you find yourself caught in some habitual sin, you'll find it helpful to find one or two friends as a safe place to confess your sin and to stand strong with you as you regain victory. And so if you find yourself in a place where you've given into something over and over and over again, it's actually become a habit in your life, you need to find one or two safe places. And I mean safe. People, spiritual people, who are able to restore, not condemn. Spiritual people who won't go around gossiping about you. Hey, you'll never guess what so-and-so did. No, just people that are a safe place. Share with them and ask them to pray with you, to stand strong with you, and to hold you accountable and bring you into a place of victory. Where you look is where you go. So that's if we're sin-focused. If you're focused on your sin, you'll hit it every time. And so the second and final point is so important, and this is where our key to victory lies, focused on righteousness, being righteousness conscious. Now, righteousness in this context refers to being in a right relationship with our Heavenly Father, right with Him. And that's what James goes on and talks about in James 1, verses 16 and 17 in our text. He says, "Don't be deceived, my dear brothers and sisters. Every good and perfect gift is from above, coming down from the Father of the heavenly lights, who does not change like shifting shadows." There's a couple of things here that he talks about. First of all is resisting deception. He starts this section by saying, "Don't be deceived." Now, we find that about four or five times in the New Testament where the writer says, "Don't be deceived." Now, you can be deceived on any point of truth, but when the Bible takes time to actually stop and say, "Don't be deceived," you can reckon that there's a really important point about to come where, at which point, deception is particularly bad. And so he says here, "Don't be deceived." The problem with deception is it's incredibly deceptive. And so don't be deceived, he says here. And sin is deception. Sin deceives us into making us think that we're missing out on something. You think about the root of any area of sin or temptation in your life, it's always that you think you're about to miss out. That was the very first sin in the Garden of Eden with Adam and Eve. And they had everything. They had absolutely everything. God said, "Here it is. It's all for you, freely. Just don't touch that tree." That tree. And then they became focused on the one thing that God said, "Don't touch." Ooh, that tree. Every other tree, freely given, that tree. And then this little whisper comes into their ear. "Ah, if you touch that one, God knows that if you touch that, you'll become like Him." In other words, two things. Number one, God is a cosmic killjoy. He's put something there, told you not to touch it, because He knows that's actually going to be something that elevates you to become like God. Total lie. And secondly, guys, you're missing out. Touch that one. Eat that one. You're missing out. And so they gave into. They were dragged away. They were enticed. And we're still living with the consequence of that bad decision. Don't be deceived. When you're tempted, realize that it's a temptation because you feel like you're missing out on something. But you're not missing out on anything. And you'll know the truth of that if you give into it. And the second thing that James teaches here is focus on relationship, focus on righteousness. He talks about the Father of the heavenly lights who does not change like shifting shadows. This is a beautiful picture. The Father of the heavenly lights, the Father. It's all about relationship, righteousness, our relationship with the Father. The Father of the heavenly lights, the sun, the moon, the stars. The heavenly lights create shadows. on the earth. I believe it's going to be sunny this afternoon, about 22 degrees, nice autumn day. And if you go out after church and the sun is shining, your shadow will be in a particular direction. But later in the afternoon, if you go out again, your shadow will be longer and in a different direction. Why? Because the earth moves and the direction of the sun changes. Same with the moon. And so the shadows constantly shift. But the Father who made the heavenly lights is not like them. He's not like the shadows that shift. He is always the same. And that's what James is saying here. Don't be deceived. God is good and always good. And so we are to focus on our relationship with our good, good Father. I taught you this in the Lord's Prayer at the beginning of the year. It's fascinating how the Lord's Prayer starts with relationship. When the disciples went to Jesus, they said, teach us how to pray. He gave them this beautiful crafted prayer. And he started not with sin. He started with relationship. Our Father. That word, Aramaic word, Father, Abba, Papa. It's a little baby word of absolute love, trust, beautiful relationship. He said, I want you, when you pray, when you spend time with the Lord, start there. That's where we need to focus, church, on the relationship we have with our Abba, with our Father who is as close to us as the air that we breathe. Hallowed be your name. And then it talks about your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today the bread that never runs out. And then it talks about sin, way down the bottom of the list. It's almost like a, by the way, forgive us of the things that we've done wrong, the lines that we've crossed, the times that we've trespassed, and we'll forgive the people that have crossed the line with us. And then it says, keep us from temptation. Amen. It's the bottom of the list. Sin's important. It needs to be dealt with, but it doesn't need to be focused on. And that's the point of victory here. Where are you looking? Because sin is way down the list. Deal with it and then move on from it. Last weekend on Sunday morning, Easter Sunday, I taught you on the four benefits of the resurrection of Jesus. And one of those benefits, the fact that Jesus is alive, is that he ever lives to make intercession for us. And I don't believe that's a good translation of that Greek word, because when we think about intercession, we think about someone who is praying for us as if Jesus is standing by the right hand of the Father, constantly praying for all of us. And I don't doubt that there's a measure of that, but the Greek word means so much more. The Greek word literally means to hit the mark. It's an archery term. And I want you to imagine this morning over this side of the platform, there's a big archery target. In the middle is the bullseye. And someone told me last night after the service that the middle of the target is not just called the bullseye, it's called the gold, which I love. So we want to get the gold. Amen? And the Bible says that in our own strength, it says, for all have sinned and what? Fallen short. That's an archery term as well. It's like there's someone with a bow and arrow and they're doing their level best to hit the target. But in our own strength, in our own ability, the very best that we can do as in our own humanity is always fall short of the target. For all have sinned and fallen short of the target of God. We always miss out on gold. But then this beautiful promise, Jesus ever lives to help us hit the mark. And so in my own strength, I miss the mark on a regular basis. But because of Jesus, I hit the mark every time. In Jesus Christ, you get gold every time. Oh, Lord, I missed again. No, you didn't. Because Jesus is alive. You hit the mark. You're spot on. The best equivalent we have today is high five, where God says, oh, Lord, I missed it. Yeah, I know you did, but Jesus died and rose again. High five. It's all good. That's where our victory lies, church. Not in focusing on our sin, but focusing on who we are and what we have in Jesus Christ. when we focus on righteousness, that is the relationship we have with the Father, because of Jesus, we reap all the good and perfect gifts that come from the Father of the heavenly lights, who does not change like shifting shadows. He's always the same. He's always dependable. I want to finish with one more verse and one very simple illustration in 2 Corinthians chapter 5 and verse 21. And it says that God made him, Jesus, who had no sin, to be sin for us, so that in him we might become the righteousness of God. All the way through the New Testament, it uses accounting terminology, not just archery terminology. And here Paul is using accounting terminology. He talks about invariably righteousness being credited to us. In other words, right relationship. And what happens when you accept what Jesus Christ has done for you through his death and resurrection, and I'm going to give people an opportunity to accept, personally accept what Jesus has done for you in just a few minutes' time. Two direct debits take place. I want you to imagine that there's two bank accounts, yours and Jesus. Our one is full of sin. It's full of all the things that we've done wrong, our mistakes, our failures, our shortcomings, where we've constantly missed the mark. That's our account. Jesus' account is full of righteousness. It's full of right relationship with the Heavenly Father. And when you say yes to Jesus, two direct debits take place. First of all, he direct debits all of your mistakes, failures, and sins out of your account and puts it in his, because that's what was dealt with on the cross. And then he takes his righteousness, his relationship, and he direct debits it out of his account into ours. And that's where our victory lies. We are in a right relationship with our Heavenly Father because of Jesus Christ. That's something to really get happy about, I reckon. It's a wonderful truth. And church, that's what we need to focus on. Yeah, I know we all make mistakes. I know we all make failures. I know we sometimes give in to the same thing over and over again. But deal with it. Agree with God. You know what? I did wrong. I am sorry. God says, fine. Forgive you, cleanse you, move on. Don't become self-indulgent even after God has forgiven you and you still haven't forgiven yourself. And you just go around and mope and have a little pity party and invite yourself and nobody else because you want to enjoy it all on your own. Just deal with it in Jesus Christ and stop focusing on the sin. Focus on your right relationship and who you are because of Jesus. Amen? Wonderful. Let's bow in prayer together, shall we?